Good evening.
Good evening, how are you?
Good.
Mike and I are here tonight to do our update, and we wanted to share just a few highlights with you this time on what's been going on in the Department of Community Services. And I just wanted to start with a thank you that July 1st began our FY22 budgeting year, approving a new position in the Area Agency on Aging. And it is with great pleasure that I can announce the promotion of Ann Sparks, who is here with me tonight. She can wait. As the Chief of Aging and Transportation. Annie brings a wealth of knowledge, has been with us for 9 years, and has over 10 years experience in supervision. She's very familiar with, closely with two of the divisions of aging already, and just gets to tackle learning the transportation division, which she has my transit administrator, Maynard Nash, right behind her to help her show the ropes. So we are very much looking forward to this. And for those of you who don't know, this position will actually replace a position that I held in 2006 as the, did I do that right? 2006 as the director, a sole director of aging. In 2011, with the recession and the reorganization of the county, we went from 12 county agencies down to 5. And that's when Mike and I joined forces, and I became the Director of Community Services. So to say this is long overdue, it's just a tad bit, but we're really excited. So now I can work with Mike more and learn more about being the Director of actual Community Services as opposed to the daily management of the aging department itself. So looking very forward to that. Her first effective day will be tomorrow. But of course, since she's an internal promotion, she will be filling her position first as a senior center administrator, which just posted today. So we're excited to be looking for a new administrator for that division. And then we have an update on Mike's programs for the critical workforce.
Yes, we have just one of the, as you all are very much aware, we've got a lot of money from COVID. So one of the specific ones that came through the Division of Housing and Community Services was Emergency Rental Assistance Program. And we got one of the biggest awards that I've ever, since I've been in the housing office, received. We're used to getting maybe, we are lucky if we got $120,000 to help people avoid eviction this year through, I think, September of next year. We got $1.6 million. I got to tell you, that was huge. I mean, my eyes go large, and we've told we're going to be getting more in another round potentially. I said, how are we ever going to spend that? But so far, we've already spent about $6 million of it. We've supported actually 101 families, keeping them from possible eviction.
Wait a minute, you got
600,000. Sorry.
100. I was going to say 6 million on 100 families.
Yeah. What did I say?
How 6 much? Million.
Six
Sign
million.
Me up.
Yeah.
He was shooting high.
Sorry.
That's government.
Thank you.
Math there.
So we've spent about 600,000 of it so far, excuse me, and for about 100 families through the end of October. We also have money for utility assistance, which we spent not quite as much, about $25,000 doing that. And we also have a piece in there on for legal support and legal aid, which we've actually taken some constituents you've referred and used some of that money to help with that. But I also want to, and that's pretty much the overview on that, but I also want to emphasize, though, that while we're working real hard to support the tenants to keep eviction, we're also really working to do our best to support the landlords. The whole purpose of this is not just to help the tenants. We want to keep them housed, but you know, as you all know, probably better than most, is that they're small business owners, and this is their investment, or this is their income, and we're doing our best to try to make sure that the funding is getting to them quickly and as much as possible. There's always a little bit of issues going on, but we hope that the landlords are feeling the respect also from the program. So that's kind of the big points. And the way we do that is by listening, by paying attention, by responding to them, and also by trying to, once the referrals come in, to get the payments out very quickly, within hopefully 2 weeks after we have a full application. And not only are we working hard on that in our office, but the folks in finance are extremely helpful in making that happen.
So, Mike, are there caps on that, how that works? Or is it based on income caps? You know, because obviously I can't see us supporting somebody with a $6,000 a month mortgage so they don't get evicted, things like that. I mean, is it done based on income?
It is done. It's done based on income, but the limits are a lot higher, or much more higher than typical. So we can do anywhere from 80% of median income. So to put that in perspective, if you take a family of four, they could be making up to $79,900 currently for a family of four. It varies on family size, et cetera. But for a family that's got a full income of $79,900, we can help them. So, which is typically higher than what we go.
But is there a cap on the rent that we pay for them?
The cap on the rent that we pay for them is we can pay up to 12 months of overdue rent, going as far back as March 13th. We can pay up to 12 months of overdue utilities, and we can pay up to 3 months into the future. But there is no amount that we're aware of that we have to stop at. Mm-hmm. It's more of a time thing. It's like nothing I've ever seen, quite frankly.
Like $300 every week for free kind of deal.
Well, it takes you, it potentially, they've got to prove that it's affected by COVID and things like that, but those thresholds aren't, the tests aren't that strict. I mean,
does it have a sunset on it at all right now? I know you're saying 3 months passed, but does it have any immediate sunset or one that's in the program?
Well, the grant runs out in
September of next year. But there's rumors that there's more money behind it in the next administration or the current administration funding.
And I think it's important too, Mike, to mention that the rents that are being paid as assistance or aid for these folks, so they're not evicted, the payments are going right to the property owner, the landlord.
And actually, the answer is yes, but no, because they are going directly to the landlords. In our county, we are doing that 99.9% of the time. And before we got this money, 100%. But this money from the feds actually allows us to pay the tenant directly, which is very scary. But in our office, unless it's very special circumstance, we always pay the landlord directly.
Very good.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mike. And I skipped right over. I said critical workforce and went right to you. But I wanted to thank the Department of Human Resources. And I was very excited earlier when I heard the part-time position goes to a full-time position there, because they have been working their tails off literally for us, because our struggle with getting employees on, our vacancy, especially in the transportation division, we had been floating along with five full-time vacancies. And when you put one or two people either on vacation or on FMLA or out sick, it has been a tremendous challenge to meet the needs of the transportation program and just giving the people the rides they need, covering our routes, doing everything. We just went through the second round of interviews. The first round did not produce, so to speak. Our greater challenge is the CDL driver, of course, but CDL shortage is a nationwide issue. We have altered positions and turned many into non-CDL bus drivers. Any that we can, we have done so. The newer fleet that we have coming, if it ever gets here, please come soon. We're buying smaller buses so that we don't have to have the CDL license to drive it. So our plan is to try to increase the applicant pool, and we did so by you allowing the critical workforce plan for employees. We did increase the grade and salary of the bus drivers, which we hoped helped the second round. We hope it'll continue to help. And this is going to be the future of the county overall for us to be a competitive market to get employees on our workforce and to maintain them. So we just wanted to thank HR and thank you for approving that for them. So
So in the past, Cathy, did you have trouble getting drivers? Has this always been an ongoing problem? Or do you think this is a COVID-related problem with people not wanting to come back to work, that kind of thing? What, I mean?
Transit is a kind of a vicious cyclical program, if I put that correctly. We always have a challenge getting people on, especially in transportation. It has been a challenge. over my years, and that's a long time being here, we've altered the program itself, where years ago we had, when I first started, 27 years ago, we had all full-time drivers. And we had good drivers, and you kept them. And eventually, because of you know, their longevity, they ended up costing a really lot of money when you look at it, when times were good. So we altered, say, 10 years ago, and we went to part-time, too. We did a mix. Part-times you can't keep. You just can't hold on to them. So that made it a challenge. We even made their rate higher, you know, just for a part-time contractual position. We've tried every model. We're back to full-time drivers because they're more maintainable. And then we have a couple, just three now, floating contractual workers. But those contractual workers, I have to have CDLs because they're going to fill in. They may fill in for any route, any bus driver that's off. So I can't take the chance to have a non-CDL. Those three positions have been vacant for six months, something. 16. So it is tough. It is tough. In this last pool, Maynard's just hired four full-time drivers, and we could only squeeze one CDL. So once we get these in place, because HR is so backed up too, is once we get these guys in place, then we're going to work on trying to advertise for the CDL contractual part-timers, because we really need that backup. You know, if somebody calls out, it's not like, I mean, no offense to even Mike and myself, I'll pick on us. We're at a desk. We're doing all kinds of things, and we can keep doing them, but we're not driving a bus. When you're driving a bus, if somebody calls out, I have to have somebody else to fill it. So those three contractual positions are crucial to keep us running. So we're hoping to go in a positive direction. We made it through this second round, so and having that full staff in there is just, you know, phenomenal, because we've ended up turning people down. We went from a 2-day window to reserve a trip to a 2-week window to reserve a door-to-door medical trip. And that's not the way we want to operate. So we'll be very happy to be full staffed again. So thank you for asking. And I would be amiss before I get into the really fun part, which is really quick, but I would be amiss if I didn't mention, I come in here and we highlight the good, bad, and the ugly here, you know. So, and I have to say, for the past 2 months, one of my duties as director of aging, all these years, is to be a guardian for wards of the state, which are individual seniors over 65 who have no family, no one else to take care of them. And they're deemed incompetent. They're not able to make decisions for themselves. And plenty of people have already been through and dug through, is there family, is there someone, is there anyone? And sometimes it ends up with us. We have always had a history of having very few of these individuals, which is wonderful. Probably means we're not aware of all the people that need it, but you go to Baltimore City and they have over 300 guardian clients. Right now I have three. Which is high for us right now. But I've spent the last month dealing with two in particular, in and out of hospitals. I've had one go from a nursing home to a hospital to hospice, and now maybe back to a nursing home. I have another one who, you know, went to the hospital, and I'm talking to doctors, I'm talking to discharge planners, nurses, the people taking care of them constantly. You know, they called me at 8 o'clock last night, the doctor from the facility, to give me a diagnosis on this person, and what do we do with them, and this and that. And I'm just, it's an unreal position to be in. It is like taking care of your parent. That's how I treat it. They're mine, but I don't know them, and they don't know me. We learn about them through their families, or through, not their families, they don't have families. We learn about them from the histories that's been maintained. One of them, I've learned more about him because of his attorney, who's the proper guardian of property. I just have to say that, and some of the work that our staff does for these folks, it's phenomenal, but it's stressful, it's hard, it's tough. You know, you're making decisions. I sat in court last month. you know, thanks to the help of Patrick and his staff, they really help us represent these individuals. So I just, today was a tough day with one of them. So it, these are humans and they deserve all that they can get. So we're glad that we get to keep doing that. So now on to the fun part. The Department of Aging was established in 1981. So we had our 40th anniversary celebration, which you all enjoyed with us, that fortunately happened because we went to the, through the Commission on Aging Senior Center tour that they love to hold, and they appreciate very much your participation in them. It shows your commitment and your dedication to the department, to the staff, and to the seniors who participate in all of our programs. So for those that are fortunate enough to have their health and their enjoyment of socialization, this is the place to be. So on our open house, I just thought I would share a few fun things for the day. And this was one of our stops at Graysonville, and I was appreciative of them doing the sign with us. And they did a lot of work on 40 years of awesome, better with age. So, oops, here we go. So here's one of the things, and our senior center manager, Ann Martin, did a lot of work on this, and I thought it was fun. You know, the kids today are all into selfies and taking pictures and everything, so that turned out fun. And the seniors that see you there and doing that, that means the work.
Go back.
There you go. There we go.
One of the residents.
They were going to keep him.
That was the commissioner's contribution to the 40th anniversary.
He was very busy talking to the seniors while we were playing with the pictures at first. So he was later getting his picture, but we didn't let him get away. So, and then in one of the centers, the seniors played bingo. They were very active. And in each center that day on our tour, we had a table set up with all of the information that the department has to offer, including transportation, all of the in-home services that we do and everything. So
just real quick, if you go back to the bingo slide. So when they play bingo, they actually get to go to a table and pick a prize if their bingo card is the winning bingo card. They get to go to a table and pick out something that is useful to them, a household item, whether it be toilet paper or paper towels or soap or shampoo or any of that kind of stuff. Is there a program that maybe we can boost right now while we have people here listening and attending the meeting?
For donations.
That if they want to make donations of some household items and things that are new?
Okay. Well, let me defer to Annie for just a second to ask, the senior center, does the site council, or do we pay for those prizes, the bingo prizes?
Basically, the bingo program itself pays for the prizes. Some of the seniors do donate things if they're new, unopened.
Okay, so my question is, can
sure.
citizens, is there a place where citizens can drop off some items that if someone's bingo card is a win, they can go to the table and pick something off?
You could go to any senior center or to the main department over here
and drop
stuff
some
off,
items off
as long as it's new. And I know it's a busy time with Thanksgiving and Christmas coming, but and we do a lot of baskets and things with the churches for individuals, but sure, if you wanted to donate to the bingo program itself, we'd gladly accept.
So a box of things that you want to contribute to the bingo program and write bingo on it?
Yep.
And you guys will make sure it gets to the senior center?
Absolutely.
Okay, great.
Thank you. Now I have to try to get back to where it was. Okay. Finally, Pickin' and Grinnin'. Pickin' and Grinnin' has been around for a very long time. Pickin' and Grinnin', the name, is actually a band that plays good old-fashioned country music that goes to the Southersville Senior Center every Thursday night and has about 80 participants every week. They volunteer. They bring, usually they can get snacks or sodas or something from the senior center. We have an aide that goes there and opens and closes the building. Years ago, I didn't have those aides or those senior center assistants that could help us do that, so we closed down. This is how demanding Pickin' and Grinnin' was, because we tried to shut it down one time.
Total riot.
And now that you guys have all been there, you see why. It can't be shut down. It's so worthwhile. The people there have a fantastic time. It's a healthy event. It's a good event. We really enjoy it. So they were so super appreciative to be able to enjoy your catered meal of Adam's ribs on October 21st. And not only did you serve it, pay for it, do all that, you also got there and you looked me square in the eyes and said, "What's for dessert?" And I was like, "I'm not sure." So thanks to Commissioner Moran and Commissioner Dumanel, they rode up the street to our local Parkside Deli and bought every pie and every cake they had. And then came back and we all cut it and sliced it and put it on plates and served everybody dessert. So
Commissioner Moran paid for all of it.
That's all good.
Thank you very much.
A lot of pies.
I was there to carry everything in.
It was a team effort.
No pie left at the end of the night either.
No. One piece of pie. Yeah.
But the financial credit certainly goes to Commissioner Murray.
I wanted to highlight that night. Now, in this picture, I apologize. Phil's not in it because he was running around trying to make a grand entrance. I don't know whether he was going to fly or what he was going to do. But you can see they were following the guidelines of food safety. They had their gloves on, and everybody had a grand time. It was wonderful. Here is proof of the pies. They even gave them their own container from Parkside, which
was returned.
Yeah. Which was returned.
Okay.
With the milk crates, everything.
So
we not only enjoyed the event, we stimulated the economy from Kent Island to Southersville that night. this was preparing of the sauces. You can see the hands-on action in the kitchen.
And I'm supervising in the back,
you can
see.
Yes, it was very helpful. From the dining room perspective, this is what the folks got to get up and get to. I had a few staff there that were helping us in the background. You'll see Annie on the right smiling as always. And then we go on. Now Phil's really excited.
It's
here.
Like Phil's looking in the mirror.
I got to meet.
Got to meet your idol.
I got to meet my idol.
That's it.
Yep. That's Elvis.
And the inflatable Phil.
Yes. And then this is the group. It shows you the size of the event. A lot of people there. They were so excited. And some people came that have never come before because they heard you were bringing food. So that was an extra plus. Now. This is a special picture because our esteemed county administrator, when we realized it was getting really hot in the kitchen, we have a problem. Now, usually Southersville's HVAC system is freezing and everybody has sweaters and they are cold, but that night it decided to quit. So our top chief engineer of all times started working on that and fortunately called his... protégés, and we had a nice young man come out and spend his only evening that he had at home fixing our air conditioning for us. So we thank you, Todd, also. And then this is proof that they wash dishes.
Job done.
This was very important.
I also supervised that as well.
Yes. Yes, we
actually, you were the one on the bottom there. We were probably getting you.
With his head under the water.
And dancing. So one of the final events of the night is Phil and Jack very, very kindly got out there and danced with folks and had a good time. Now, I'm pretty sure Jim refused.
Yeah.
Couldn't find Todd. I'm not sure where the rest of you were, but they were just thrilled. They were thrilled.
I step on a senior citizen's toes, they're going to know about it for months to come. So not a good idea.
That's the end. So I just want to thank you. Wanted to say that thank you for letting me get proof and share it with the world. It means everything to us. And as always, your presence and support is important not only to this department, but to the staff and to the participants.
But if you want to give a plug while we're here, because we can't leave out the other two.
Oh, yes. I had that in there. Sorry. The next two coming up, because we can't leave anyone out.
Right.
That was for Southersville, December 1st. We will be going to Kent Island Senior Center and doing Adam's Ribs is there as well. And then you graciously offered to take over the dinner for the holiday gala, which is December 17th at the Graysonville Senior Center, and we're having Italian night.
Very good Italian.
Yes. And where is that from?
Avanti's.
Avanti's.
Yes.
Perfect. Thank you very much. That was a recommendation, and they're very excited. So we're looking forward to it again.
Excellent.
So.
Bada bing.